So I know I'm the last session of the day. So I think I'm the only one standing between you and the beers. So I will try to make it a short session, but still give you an overview of the automation fund I had in Azure. And oh, I thought someone was already laughing. So of course, first a thank you to all the sponsors, because they make this day happen, allowing us all to share our knowledge and information. So I, as a speaker, am always very grateful to be able to have these opportunities to share with you my small DevOps adventure. For those of you who do not know me already, my name is Esther. I've been in IT for over 20 years now. I know it's a very youthful look, but the age is a bit different, so I do have some experience. And I've also been very active in the community for the last couple of years. Started more in the Citrix community, focusing on all kinds of Citrix products. And for the last couple of years, I've also been very active in the Microsoft MVP community. And because I think it's important to find the other women in technology, even though I think diversity is a whole different topic and I don't want to get into that debate. I did realize that sometimes it's not so easy to find the other women out there because we're not always very good promoters of ourselves and our skills. So we started, me and the other two female CTPs in the Citrix program, we started a mentorship program to allow more women to find each other, to talk about both improving our technical skills, but also developing more or grow as persons, helping each other out, sharing battle stories. So that's one of the things that I've been really enjoying, mentoring others. But in light of today and PowerShell and Azure, I've been investing a lot of time the last couple of years diving into the whole DevOps experience, doing automation based on PowerShell scripts. And with a focus on Citrix NetScaler, I kind of got the nickname of being the Nitro Queen as Citrix. Welcome, just take your time. I'm still doing the introductions, don't worry. No big secrets are out yet. Earning myself the title Nitro Queen because Citrix fondly calls their REST API for the NetScaler Nitro. So that's for some of you that have no idea why that was up there. So today, this evening, at the end of, or starting of the evening? Yeah, it's still 4, right? So it's not yet 5 o'clock, no beers yet, right? It's a small agenda just to make sure that we go through the basics. I'm taking you on an adventure, so I'm slowly, or I'm showing you the different steps that I took and the different experiences that I got getting into the whole Azure automation. Starting with ARM templates, and then really diving into the automation fund. As I said, ARM templates. I think that's the first step when we're talking about Azure automation, to dive into how do I create these templates that will allow me to automatically deploy the resources within Azure. And one of the things I immediately learned, which is a benefit because from my Citrix NetScaler background, I already understood some of the JSON payloads that we need when we're making usually REST API calls. In this case, ARM templates are based on JSON. So you need to be aware of some of the JSON syntax, basically. So I wanted to make sure that we're all on the same page. So I'm just slowly starting with the basics, and then I will build it up during the presentation. For starters, if we're talking about JSON, the first rule is that it's always, all data that you provide is always in a name value pair. Separated with a colon, it's still very simple. Second rule, data is separated by commas. Still easy to understand, easy to grow into. And then we get into objects, which makes it a bit more exciting, more interesting. The curly braces contain your objects, if we're talking about JSON. And if we're talking about arrays, we have our square brackets. Needed to make sure that I got those names correct. Still very simple, very basic. The fun part is that you can nest it whatever you want, creating all kinds of different layers to provide the information that you want to Azure, for instance. And we're using this for ARM templates. It's the formatting, so the engine at the back end within Azure understands what kind of information you want to provide. And Microsoft provides you with a very basic or simple template that only holds the bare necessities. The schema is just a set line, so just copy and paste it, because that will tell Azure what the template is that is used. So it will understand how it can translate all the different JSON components to the right objects in Azure. Content version, that's for you. If you want to make sure that you implement versioning into the different ARM templates, you can just build or use your own versioning format in that. So you can start with 1.1.1 and just slowly build it up as you build your ARM templates. The parameters, those are basically your input variables. So that is the input that makes your ARM template or the custom template that you want to build reusable for different scenarios. So you just build that template, put in the specific parameters, and then it will roll out your resource with those exact settings. And then internally within your template, you can use variables. And those are basically internal variables that you can use to simplify some of the syntax. Because if you have to fully specify resource groups / network / IP configuration, et cetera, it becomes a very long string. So to simplify it, you can use variables to already dive into that specific situation. I will show some examples later on. Functions, I have to admit, I haven't looked at functions just yet because I'm still learning and I think it's already quite some adventure to get into the ARM templates and automation. But functions that the word says allows you to use functions within your template. So if you have like some simple calculations that you want to do, for instance, to basically only get like your subnet and calculate your own personalized IP addresses, you can build a function for that. Or if you want to make sure that you validate the input, create a function for that, and you can use that within your template. And then last but not least, very important, your resources, or almost last. Resources are basically the definitions of the Azure resources that you can create, like resource groups, the network interface cards, your network itself, all those objects within Azure, you can specify those within resources. And output, once again, is basically for your personal use, to make sure that once your ARM template is deployed, some of the information that is built within the template is returned to you. And I will show you some examples. Just to give you an idea, because that was a very simple example, Microsoft also provides you with like the startup template. And I know it's probably not readable at all. But this is just basically to give you an idea that there are a lot of different parameters and objects that you can specify within an ARM template. And this is not even doing multiple resources. It's just a basic example of the settings that you can do with an ARM template. So when I saw that, I'm not going to say I was totally freaked out, but I was kind of worried at how fast I could learn building my own ARM templates, if it was manageable, because basically I started 2 weeks prior to this presentation. And then I got a bit worried if I would be able to understand it in time. The good news is Microsoft has a lot of documentation on Azure, also on Azure Automation. So in addition to the page that gives you that sample template, they also provide a quick start guide. And that quick start guide makes your life very easy. Basically, what the quick start guide says is you go to Azure, to your Azure portal, you click on create a resource, you go to the marketplace and select a virtual machine. In my case, it's a NetScaler because that's like, I have a love-hate relationship with the appliance, so please don't hold it against me. Because I wanted to deploy a NetScaler appliance in Azure. So I just tried to select that, and then it kind of hit me, as you would normally deploy a resource, with all these questions. Which resource group? What network? Do you want to create a new network? Does it have a subnet? Does it only have one NIC? A lot of information that you need to put in there. Until you get to the review plus create tab. Almost there. And then if I wanted to manually deploy it, I would hit create and then be done with it. But in my case, I wanted to basically find a way to use an ARM template. That's what the quick start guide was guiding me to. So as I already marked down in the corner, there's a download link for a template for automation. That's interesting. What Microsoft does, it provides you, if you follow the normal steps through Marketplace, is that download link. It does not only provide you an ARM template, but it also provides you a parameters file that has the default settings, basically, and a PowerShell script, CLI commands, to automate your deployment. Pretty cool. And just start with ARM templates. And this way, I get basically a pre-configured ARM template. I did some customizations, and I will go, I'll explain that later on. But I get my parameter section, which has all the inputs, basically all those fill-out form values that I had to provide in the previous step. I have my internal usable variables. In this case, it's just a quick reference for the network name, the network security groups, subnet reference. So that makes that string that is pretty long very quickly an input variable in the rest of the templates for my resources. And apparently, just filling out that form automatically creates all the information I need for my network interface. All the way down to network security groups, IP addresses that I want to allocate to the network interface. So it's already pretty complete. And I even added an output section because I wanted to make sure that if I deploy that NetScaler, I at least get some information back on the admin username, the admin password, and the machine name. That will at least make it easier to find my resource once it is created and be able to simply store that information in my password manager and use it for future references. Talking about references, quickly taking a sip, Microsoft offers a lot of reference guides that will make life easier if you want to basically read that pre-generated ARM template file. In this case, I wanted to add a second network interface to my NetScaler. So I simply went to the resource page, went for the network section, and it gives you all the information. So it gives you all the properties that you can set in your ARM template. It gives you examples as well. And if you zoom in on the property values, in my case, I was looking for properties and then IP configuration, because I did not only wanted to add a second network interface, I also wanted to make sure that I would be able to assign a public IP address to my NetScaler. Because in my example, I wanted to create a load balancing configuration that would be externally addressable from the internet. So that helped me to quickly come up with an extra addition to the resources section to create a second network interface with a preset IP configuration. Basically, using a private IP address that is dynamically assigned, and then adding a public IP address to it that is statically a static IP address, just to make sure that it doesn't change on me after each reboot of the machine. So I'm not going to say it was just a few clicks, but still, one day of puzzling and trying and retrying and adjusting and tweaking, and I had my ARM template, which I could easily store again in Azure, and then simply use the Azure functionality deploy to basically deploy new NetScaler appliances within Azure. Still need to provide some input. The good news is that if I define some default values for my parameters, some of the information, like the resource group in my case, is already pre-filled. So the real things that I needed to provide was my virtual machine name and the administrator password, if I'm not mistaken, because those are those have the little check marks behind it. So that's the actual information that I didn't specify with a default value in the ARM template. And then simply check the box that you agree, hit purchase, and the bill will come. And the machine will get deployed. And what I really like about it is that all the different components that I specified within my ARM template are just shown as the different resources that it's creating. So it's telling me that it is creating that first network interface, my second one, it's creating a public IP address, et cetera, et cetera. And then after 4 minutes and 46 seconds, so basically 5 minutes, I have a network appliance in Azure, fully deployed with some information attached to it. Pretty cool, I thought, but still requires some manual actions. So I really like those ARM templates because that make my life a lot easier to automate and to make sure that every time I automate it, it has the same settings and configuration, which can be very useful for like a DR scenario if you want to do that in Azure. But I thought maybe there's more to automate. So I started to look at the PowerShell module for Azure to use Azure RM, which is pretty simple. You just do use the install module command, specify the module. And then in my case, I had not the latest PowerShell. So it had old PSGET installed, which generated an error because that old ps-get that is used by default was linking to a library that doesn't exist anymore. Good news is there's a very easy solution for that, because you can prefix your install module commandlet with PowerShell get, and that will let PowerShell know to actually use the internal ps-get commandlet for this action. That makes it easier. So just wanted to let you know that that was my experience. Don't make my mistakes, learn from them. Just to be sure, use it. And then you get a lot of commandlets, which still is a lot of get help to try to understand all the input and how to use it. Luckily for me, Microsoft has a reference guide. So that makes it easier to find the right commandlets and to figure out how to use them. So I started with the basically getting started with Azure RM guides on from Microsoft. And it started with giving an example of using the login Azure RM account commandlet. Only downside to that is that it uses a pop-up to simply ask you for your login name and password to authenticate you against Azure. And then it gives you access and allows you to do the PowerShell remote commandlets against Azure. Not exactly the way I wanted to go, because I'm looking for a way to automate each and every step within Azure. So luckily for me, Azure Active Directory, Azure AD, gives you something called Service Principle. And a Service Principle basically is an application ID and key, password, that allows you to give access, specific rights, to that application within Azure. So you can even downsize the automation parts that you can address to a resource group or to your entire subscription if you feel bold and brave. But you can downsize it to, for instance, only one resource group that you wanted to use. So to create a service principle, you have to go to Azure AD, go to application registrations, and simply add a new application registration. So if you do that, it will create an application ID for you. And if you go down to keys, you can generate your secret or your password, which can be a key, or you can even use a certificate if you would like to be even more secure and use that certificate as the thumbprint of the certificate to log on to Azure. In my case, I just used, I generated a key, and the password will only be shown when you create that key. So as you can see, if you scroll back, if you leave the page and you go back to that created key, it's hidden and there's no way to, well, there are PowerShell scripts to change it, but there's no way to retrieve it from the GUI. So make sure that you write it down or log it in your password manager. If that works for you, if that's your password manager system, then kudos for you, but I'm not entirely sure if that's the best way to go. But then again, I would love to have your Azure account to do some Bitcoin mining or see if I can use burn up some of those credits. Yeah. The other thing that you need to make sure that you can log on with the Service Principle is your tenant ID, which you can also find in Azure AD. If you simply go to the properties of your Azure AD, in the middle screen or the next screen, you can find something called directory ID. Because why would you name it tenant ID if that's the name of the parameter? Doesn't make sense, right? we need to be a bit sportive about it, make it creative. So it's the directory ID in the GUI. It's tenant ID as the parameter. So now I can basically create a credential based on that application ID and the key. And I can specify, that's the creation. Oh yeah, I just wanted to make sure for demos that it didn't show all my subscription ID and all the stuff, because somehow people seem to be very keen on noting that down. So I just simply used a CSV file to store them. And as Jaap already pointed out, there are smarter ways to do that. So just in case you have questions about that. This is me still learning. So this was the quickest way within the 2 weeks that I had to at least not make that visual. So you create your credentials, supply your tenant ID, and make sure that you use the service principle switch in this commandlet as well. And then it just automatically logs you on Azure and allows you to use all the remote commands. So if I want to do that ARM template, there is a simple commandlet, the new Azure RM resource group deployment, which is like a simple name, right? That asks you to specify the resource group that you want to deploy your resources in. The template file, which is your ARM template. And in my case, you could specify all the input parameters for your ARM template as parameters with the command. But I thought it was easier to create the object template parameter, which is another way of doing it that Azure prescribes. And this made it easier for me to use like variables or have like constants in my script. Those are the values that it will actually use for your ARM template. So in my case, these are all the parameters that I put at the beginning of my ARM template. So like location, if you saw the previous slides, it said location as first. And then all these are also specified as input parameters for my ARM template. And you just have the option, the parameter template parameter object with this commandlet that allows you to just push them as one object to the commandlet. And then I thought, this is pretty cool. I now am able to just use my management server or personal computer in my case, because I'm just having like my lab fun. And I can create a PowerShell script that uses all that stuff, that uses a local ARM template, and then I can automate my deployments. I'm getting there. Azure isn't so bad. I can automate my deployments for NetScaler. But I figured deployment is nice, but I wanted to take it one step further. Why not only deploy my NetScaler automatically? Why not also configure it automatically? All in one script. I can do that by creating another public IP address, linking that to my NetScaler, but then I would create basically a security breach, because I would allow internet access with management capabilities to my NetScaler. And if I'm not very carefully removing that after the configuration, then I might just not be the smartest girl in town. So I was looking at other options that I could have, like using Azure Automation, which provides me with runbooks, and something called hybrid workers. Looking at runbooks, you simply create an automation account within Azure, and then you can import PowerShell scripts as runbooks, or you can create a runbook from scratch using PowerShell. You can even use Python if that's the language that you prefer. So I already created a script. Basically, I used that PowerShell script that I was testing on my local machine and just imported that into Azure as a runbook, because it had all the different steps that I wanted to use. And with runbooks, you can simply hit start or edit if you want to make some last minute changes. Or you can simply run that runbook. And as you can see, you have two different options if you run a runbook. You can either run it on Azure, or you can use what they call a hybrid worker, which basically is a machine, either on premises, using your Azure connection, or in Azure itself. And I created a hybrid worker in Azure because I wanted it to be in the same subnet as my NetScaler, because that would allow me to, after the deployment, to quickly connect with my NetScaler within that internal network on Azure. So I wouldn't need any remote access to my NetScaler, still keep it very safe.
May I ask a question?
Yes. Yeah, so if you want to use a hybrid worker, I'll explain the steps, because basically I was trying to figure it all out as well. So what I did is I just simply deployed a Windows 2016 machine within Azure, within the same resource group and the same VNet that I wanted to use for my NetScaler. And then you just run the install module for Azure RM, because those are the commandlets that I want to use within my runbook. So I had to make sure that that module was installed on the worker. And the good news is there is a simple script called new on-premise hybrid worker.ps1 that you can download from Microsoft Gallery. And that will set up all the all the modules that it requires and all the settings on your hybrid or on your virtual machine to allow it to be connected to your automation account. And that's one of the reasons why you need to provide some information during when you run that script. So it needs your automation account name. It needs an automation account, the resource group that it is deploying in. I think it's optional to use the Log Analytics workspace name and the OMS resource group name. But just to be sure, I just created everything. So, I have no idea what I'm doing sometimes, but at least this is the easy way to not run into a lot of distracting errors that might just take me all day. And then at the end, I'm going like, oh, I just needed to add those optional ones to make life easy. And a hybrid group name, and that's the name that you saw in the previous slide, that I chose the hybrid group name. So you don't have to create that in advance. You just use the script, and then it will create that group if it's not there yet, and add your worker to it. And what I really like about the hybrid workers is that basically it still allows me to use local modules or install local modules or use local files or use a file share as input, especially because I'm using that CSV file with all my secret data and logon codes. Because I thought, well, if I'm using Azure Automation, how cool is it that it has a key vault that allows me to store even encrypted information? And then I discovered if you want to use or address the keys that are in your key vault, you need to log on to Azure first. So I want to store my logon information in the key vault. Yeah, you get the picture, right? So that's why I decided I'm just gonna use that hybrid worker, because one, it allows me to use local information or network information if I'm running it on premises instead of in Azure. But it also allows me to have that direct connection to my NetScaler and do all the configuration commands afterwards. Oh yeah, Of course, I highlighted it to make sure that I would point it out. So I figured this is a lot of information. And I don't know about you guys, but for me, it always works to visualize it and to see it. And I really wanted to do like a live demo. But Azure isn't the fastest if we're talking about resource deployment. And I didn't want to let you go through that emotion because I'm a very impatient girl. So I keep hitting refresh. And I know it's not a pretty sight to see me hit refresh for 4 minutes before I have that NetScaler appliance available. So what I did is I recorded everything. So I will run a video that speeds through all those moments. And the camera's not on me. The camera's still on the screen, so don't worry. Just to make sure that we have enough time for drinks. And if you like to get a live demo, we can always do that during those drinking fun. Maybe that's even better, to have a beer while you're hitting refresh all the time. So let's check it out. The runbook. So you could hit start right away, but with few, I could simply give you an overview. And I hope it's still readable in the back because it's kind of blurred out, but okay, thanks. So what I did is I had different sections. I'm running through it very fast, but the first section will log on to Azure from my hybrid worker. The second section, this is a long scroll. The second section will create my NetScaler. Yes, it takes a lot of commands to explain this. Maybe I should hit pause for a minute. Hang on. Did you read that? To explain that scrolling, I have different sections. So the first section is just to log on to Azure, as I said. The second section of the script is to create that NetScaler appliance based on the ARM template. And what you saw in the template is that I already basically reserved different IP addresses. Some public IP addresses, some private IP addresses. And the private IP addresses are reserved dynamically, so they can change after a reboot. So I needed another section to make sure that I got all that IP information for my NetScaler. Because even though I have linked all those IP addresses to the network interfaces, my NetScaler still has no clue what it should be configured. So what I'm doing is after the NetScaler is created, I'm reading all that information, getting the IP addresses from my network interface, store them in variables, and then I run the last section, which was all the scrolling. That's all the REST API commands that I'm pushing to my NetScaler to configure it. And that's like 31 steps just to do simple load balancing and a basic configuration. So maybe that explains to you why I'm very keen on automating NetScaler configurations. It's a lot of screens, it's a lot of typing. It can get ugly. So what we're looking for at the end of the runbook is simple output. Everything is done, we're good to go. Hitting play again, hopefully. So let's deploy. Let's start that runbook. So these are the parameters, so those input variables that I need for my runbook. And I already specified default values. And so these are not the parameters for the ARM template. It's in the runbook itself. It's the top section. So it's less because I'm using a lot of pre-configured values for that ARM template. And each run book gives you basically two ways to check the output. You have the all logs, which simply logs every step. So it also logs warnings, errors, each line. And you have a separate output pane that just shows you like command line, command prompt output. So going back to that ARM template, as you can see, it has all these variables in it. And for a lot of them, I just specify the default value. So if I don't input, if I don't specify the parameter with a value, it will just simply use that default value. That makes it kind of easier to use only a subset of variables. These are the in ARM template variables. And that makes it easier to not write down the entire string, but just use the variables as references to the objects or the information. Going down to resources, as you can see, there are quite some resources that I'm specifying. In this case, the network profile needs to know which networks I'm linking to it. And then you need to specify your own section for the network itself and all properties. Different IP addresses that I specified. For those of you who have no idea how Netscalers work, the top one is Netscaler IP address. It's a subnet IP address. Those are just terms a Netscaler uses, which makes it easier for me to retrieve the right IP address for my Netscaler configuration. Oh, yeah, me and code. That's another lesson and adventure to have.
We'll talk about it.
Yes, please. I do need some help because what you will see, as you probably already figured out from the screenshots of the scripts, is that I'm still using ISA as well. So please educate me. Yeah, that would be another great session, probably. So, and these are the outputs, as I explained earlier. So I figured this would be nice to fill up that waiting time, prevent me from hitting refresh all the time. But as you can see, it's still deploying my Netscaler. Fast forward. Yes, next step. Retrieving the variables from Azure. So I'm switching to the output because I just wanted to show you that once the ARM template is deployed, it does give you a lot of information in return, like all the variables or parameters that were used and the output that I defined within my ARM template. So hoping that it is moving on. Yeah, I'll try to share with you some of the emotions I had during this video.
So you did this at 1 a.m.?
Yes, correct. I think this week, right? The 7th, yes. This weekend, yeah. While my girlfriend was screaming in the back saying, don't you have to go to bed? And then I usually say, 5 more minutes. And then it's all dark, quiet in the house. Or 2, and I sneak in the bed. She's going like, what time did you went to bed? Just, within 10 minutes. But doesn't always work. So these are all the steps. I fast forwarded because I realized that once in my script, I didn't build in some waiting time for the appliance. Because the ARM template just lets me know, oh, I'm done, it's deployed. And then the virtual machine gets booted. And with a Netscaler, that's still, well, I counted like 3 minutes, 2 is sufficient enough as well. But I just wanted to make sure. So these are the first 20 steps for the service group. And then there are still some more steps, like 31 or something like that. 30, oh, that's not too bad. But at least it's finished. So what did I do? What do I have now? Basically, what I wanted to make sure is that if I deploy that NetScaler, it's in a production environment. I need to make sure that it's configured and ready to go, as I said, with, for instance, a DR scenario. So this is just to let you know, to double check if that load balancing configuration for my external public IP address is configured correctly on the NetScaler. I will not zoom in on the NetScaler configuration because it's not very readable and it's a lot of screens to click through. But basically, there are two websites and the backend and it's load balancing. Yay, mission completed. Pretty cool, right? So I create my NetScaler virtual machine, which now has two NICs. You can do that if you deploy it from the marketplace. It will only give you one NIC. And it's kind of hard to add the second NIC afterwards. So that's a big plus with the ARM template. And if you zoom in on the IP configurations, you see all those IP addresses that I put in the ARM template. And all the objects, like the network security groups, public IP address, did something with a disk. And I figured, now that I have that custom template, and I don't know if you guys are building NetScalers or not, but it would be nice if you want, or if you wanted at least after this presentation, just see what a custom ARM template looks like. I put it all up in GitHub just to share and make sure that at least my lessons learned can become your lessons learned as well. Any questions right now? Just checking how much time we left. No questions right now. Okay.
With the hybrid worker, can I run the script of Azure to install something?
Oh, thank you for reminding me of that. So with the hybrid worker, can you run from Azure to
install
on-premises?
On my on-premise,
only if you...
Yes.
You want to use the RUM books?
Yeah, I want to put all my scripts there.
Mm-hmm.
But normally they should, they are not Azure scripts.
No, it kind of...
For example, I want to change someone's Active Directory password.
Yes.
I put it there, run from there, and change in my own...
In
premises.
Your own AD, local AD. You can do that as long as there's like a VPN connection between on-premises and Azure. And basically, you have your firewall rules in place.
Because Express Route, right?
Or Express Route, yeah, that should work as well. You just need to be aware that there are different subnets. And with all the the network security groups, you need to make sure that you have all that traffic. So your PowerShell scripts are able to remotely log on to Azure or to your AD. I'm sorry, mixing it up. And then you could use the key fold
to store my secrets.
Passwords, stuff like that. And the advantage of using the RUM books is that the RUM books can use the encrypted keys in your key fold. But if you're using a remote PowerShell, it cannot use that. So that's a RUM book specific addition, basically.
Okay. Thank you.
There was one question in the back as well.
Anyone that's doing it, obviously you've gone through the NetScaler use case.
Yeah.
Anyone that's doing their own custom machines from their own machine images, if you're doing it cross-region, you have to make sure you've got your storage accounts and your images pre-replicated before you fire up anything. So that's more of a watch out if you're doing it and wanting to customize your own image store. You basically have to have a root image store. Deploy that first, and then use all of your RUM book and automations against it.
That's a good tip, because so that was my next project.
It was a massive headache for us, because you have to make sure that you give it enough time. And also, when you form your image, you have to then take it out and put it into a custom image store that you can then push out to each of the regions into whatever security group you then pass into the automations.
Yeah, because that's one of the next things that I want to do, is to upload a custom image and then be able to use it within Azure from the blob storage, so to speak. Yeah, I have no idea how to do that.
It was a massive pain. I did it last year, so this technology has probably shifted on a little bit, so it's probably a bit more... like the automation piece wasn't up in Azure, it was on command line at that time.
That's what I'm hoping for, that it will give me some clues.
So we had to create custom Ubuntu workers and then transfer that image from a static and then basically prepare it, move it to a blob store, and then specify that blob store to then replicate out off into everyone's. Yeah.
I've done the same thing for. I have two subscriptions.
Mm-hmm.
I want to move a machine from one subscription to another one.
Oh, and
nice. Says, no, you can't do that.
No. Yeah. Computer says no.
Actually. And then I found a way. It's the same thing. It's the same thing if you want the on-premise to the storage or copy from storage to another storage between subscriptions.
Yeah, wow. AZ copy was the only way we could actually extract the image to prepare it properly.
If shared access keys or things.
Sorry.
No, no problem. Everything. No, I'm very happy that you're warning me about all the other great stuff that I am about to explore. Thank you for that. Just double checking. I still have a couple of minutes. So for those of you who already want to go to the drinks, that's fine with me.
We are not going to have drinks immediately afterwards. We have a closing session in 15
Perfect.
Minutes
yes.
in Altab, so where we had the keynote.
Okay.
We're going to have like a quick closing. You can have opportunity to fill out a feedback form for the whole conference and also the feedback form for the keynote.
Perfect.
Because we didn't have the forms ready at the time.
No
and then
problem.
Just general feedback from you guys.
But basically what I wanted to say is that I wanted to make sure that everyone is aware of the fact, because I already suppressed them in my video, but I got these weird warnings using all these commandlets, Azure RM commandlets, that parameters would be deprecated in the future. And that's really annoying for your log file, especially with the runbook, because they give basically false warnings. Why not make it informational and just be done with it? But they explained to me that there's an easy way to suppress those warning messages specifically. So all the other warnings, because now I just killed all warnings, which isn't the best approach either. So this is just to suppress those breaking change warnings within the Azure ARM. And then I had this whole bonus material, but that's one of the reasons why I said, if you want to leave, feel free to leave. But I basically had one last question, because I already am very proud of how far I got with the runbooks and Azure automation. But still, that requires, well, I can schedule it, but it still requires basically a manual hit start to deploy it. And then I discovered that you can use REST APIs, which I kind of like, being the Nitro queen, that you can use REST APIs to automatically start your Azure automation runbook job. Woohoo! So I have a video of that, but basically, well, that's a super long URL to make sure that you are within your subscription ID, resource group, et cetera, et cetera. And then I create a JSON payload, which we normally do with REST API calls. I'm not sure how familiar you all are with them. And you just specify those properties for your runbook job. starting with the runbook name. And these are the parameters that I also had the GUI ask me for. So the Netscaler name, the Netscaler password, and the Netscaler username. You saw those three boxes when I hit start of the runbook. And the run on, I had to figure that out. If you leave that parameter out, or that value out, then it will run on Azure. But if you use run on, you can specify the hybrid worker group, and then it will run on your hybrid worker. And if you're using tags, you can also add those. But then I started the infogress method, commandlet, with those parameters. And it worked! Woohoo! But you do need...
Where do you get this access token from the runbook?
Yeah, that's what... that's you need to make sure that you log on to Azure first. So you get the bearer token. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but if you want to use REST APIs, you can basically create a bearer token. So that's in the, I hope I'm going to show that in the first section. I will not play the entire video, but just to show you the script, this is to create the access token. So that's, hang on. I keep doing that, just passing through the fun stuff. Let me see if we can zoom in a little. Where did I do that? Nope. That's already section two. Yes. Just quickly go. Yes. Oh. Could have just shown it in code, probably, which is like very smart of me, right? If only I knew how to do that. I have all this stuff. This one. Can I zoom in easily, Jaap?
Yep, that's great.
Hang on, is this one? No.
Control shift plus.
Oh, look. Yeah. There it is. I can close this one. So if you look at this first section, the first part is my Azure automation account information. The API version is basically a set input value as well. I specify the runbook and that hybrid group to create that JSON payload. And then to create a bearer token, I have to go to this specific URL using your tenant ID. Trying to figure out if I remember it correctly. Basically, I kind of found some scriptlets and copied and pasted and made it look even better. So yeah, this is more like an application form instead of only using application JSON. So yeah, I'm just running against this URL. And with this body that has my ARM resource specified, client ID, which is my application ID and the application keys, the secret. So that's the same as the service principle that I use with PowerShell. Only now I'm using it to create what they call a bearer token, and then you can use that with each additional REST API call that you make by adding it to the header. So if I run this script for to start my automation runbook, you can now see, as you already noticed, that I create this extra header for my REST API call that I input that token again that it created for me. So that's how you, so you have to authenticate with REST API first, and then you can run the sequential commands or calls. So I hope this was a fun and educational session. Please give me some feedback, because I love to learn and grow as a presenter as well.
That endpoint, was it wrapped in a script block or something? Was it delimited by those curly braces earlier you when you got the token?
Yeah.
Okay, script block.
If I go back to the token.
No,
the token is basically just, I think, a base64 string. But you're talking about the token endpoint, the variable.
Yeah.
Basically, what I'm specifying here is the URL, but the curly braces with zero, that's... Oh, I have no idea. It's
part of the formatting command, because you can't use the minus if.
Yeah, of course, that's already an...
Otherwise,
yeah, I was going to say a string, but that's not... That's to make sure that I can input that variable after the minus f into the entire string that I'm building. No, I have to admit that this is the part that I copied and pasted and this is the way to do it. Let's go.
Are you saying for telephone number?
No, but
for telephone number rules, that minus X, quite handy. I don't know what's called. Someone else might know.
It's not like a regular expression, right? But
Because otherwise it would go, what's this? And then minus X, what's this? So it would get confused. So that's a way of saying that I want to perform it for string.
Yeah, so it's kind of like a regular expression, only more for formatting strings.
I've never seen the format operator used with those curly braces at the end of the string.
No, because I normally use it with my select object command to just specify the output as well. True. Yeah. Thanks for asking. Now I learned something too. So as I was saying, thank you very much for attending this presentation. If you have any feedback, let me know. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out. Let's enjoy the closing keynote and then the drinks afterwards. Because now it's 5 o'clock, not just anywhere. It's